Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Sanctuary by Katrine Engberg. Translated by Tara Chase. Read by Graeme Malcolm.
To Laura Herger, beloved sister and ally. It was the noise that woke him, a throbbing rhythm like a locomotive moving at high speed. He tried to drift back to sleep, but the rumbling in his eardrums forced him to consciousness. He shifted restlessly and felt a sharp pain on the back of his head, struggled to open his eyes, but they were stuck shut. When he attempted to raise his hand to rub them, it wouldn't obey. "I'm having a nightmare," he thought. "One of those where I dream I'm awake. I'll wake up, fully in a minute. Get up, and the day will begin." He repeated this sentence like a mantra, but even as he tried to regain control, he knew this wasn't right. He clenched his fists cautiously and noted to his relief that his fingers responded. But the relief was short-lived. A zip tie cut into his wrist. He was tied up. He blinked and forced his eyes open. His field of vision was blurred as if he were looking through a greasy camera lens. He was lying on his side and could only make out dim light and trees in the distance. Something that looked like a figure. Where was he? The last thing he remembered was parking on a strip of dirt somewhere he hadn't been before, walking through tall grass under a blue-black sky, past the outlines of buildings, and getting his trouser legs wet. He remembered that he had come here to find something. He had gone in the door of a big building. He remembered that much. And then? Pain shot upward from the back of his head, making it hard to think. The noise sapped the last of his concentration. Had he been punched? He mobilized all his strength and raised his head so he could look toward his feet. Not far from the soles of his shoes, a light flickered in time with the noise, and in a lucid moment he realized what it was. An industrial saw. He was moving toward it. A scream drowned out the noise. It took several seconds before he realized it was his own. He tugged at the zip ties in vain. They wouldn't break. He was hopelessly trapped at the mercy of the blade, which was closing in on his feet. He threw himself from side to side, his shoulders bashing into whatever was underneath him, blood dripping from a wound on his head. There must be some way for him to twist one arm free. If only he could see properly, maybe he could loosen the zip ties around his wrists and stop the saw. But he couldn't do anything. This was the end of the line. He screamed for help, a wild animal's roar. But there was no response. Monday, November 18th. Chapter 1. At first glance, the suitcase looked like something out of an old movie, a big, square travel bag with reinforced corners and a wide handle attached with rusty metal clasps. It lay in some scraggly snowberry bushes, and the damp soil had discoloured the leather and loosened the stickers, mementos from hotels in Trondheim and Hanover. Violent Crimes Department Detective Anette Werner gazed down at the playground in Oesteranlage Park. On the top of the hill there was a plateau with a bench facing one lone tree which drew a silhouette against the sky's low-hanging clouds. The kids at the playground didn't go up there much. The people who used the space often left hypodermic needles and condoms on the ground, and it was best not to go near those. The on-duty investigations officer stood in the clearing, calling the crime scene technicians and the medical examiner. His shoulders were pulled well up around his ears, so the woolen trench coat formed an arch over his back. On either side of the clearing, sets of stone steps led down the slope, both cordoned off with striped crime scene tape, which was fluttering in the wind. One of the two young officers who had called for backup stood by the farther staircase, keeping watch. Anette turned back around to the suitcase, pushed aside a dripping branch, and squatted down in the bushes beside the other young officer. The muddy soil between the bushes revealed roots from the surrounding trees, and the branches' yellow leaves hung limp. "Who found it?" She nearly lost her balance and grabbed the officer's shoulder.
"A first grader from Krebs School. They use the playground at recess and straight up here, even though they're not allowed to."
The suitcase was still covered with dirt, but one corner was sticking out. The young officer pointed to the top right corner of the suitcase. "A fox, maybe?"
"Probably. The kids got their teacher and she was alarmed by the odour and called the police."
The odour. Anette smelled wet soil and autumnal decay. The fallen leaves were already well on their way to becoming dirt, and mushrooms were starting to grow. There was a sweet, underlying note of spoiled meat behind the November scents.
"When we arrived, we carefully removed the dirt from around the suitcase, intending to open it, but..."
The young officer cleared his throat awkwardly.
"Well, it hasn't been that long since I finished the academy here in Copenhagen, and you don't forget the smell of a cadaver that fast."
Anette glanced at him and said, "So it hasn't been opened yet?"
"We just lifted the lid a little and then called you."
"Right." They heard a child's yell from the playground.
"We haven't had time to cordon things off properly yet."
The officer squirmed uncomfortably.
"There were only two of us here, you know, until you arrived."
"I can hear the dam's swish-swish sounds from the kids' snowsuits. They're that close." Anette pulled out a pair of latex gloves from her pocket. Her own daughter, Gudrun, had just gotten a new snowsuit for the winter, size 2T, sky blue with white clouds. Her golden curls got stuck in the zipper every time she insisted she could zip it up herself. At the moment, Gudrun, her snowsuit, and Sven were all off on a week-long vacation with Sven's sister in Kertheminde. Anette had started missing them as soon as the car drove down their residential street the previous day.
"I'm going to open the suitcase so we're absolutely sure, just so we don't set everything in motion for no reason."
"Oh, I don't have any doubts at all," the officer protested, wiping his dripping nose with the back of his hand. Anette slid her hands under the edge of the lid and felt the cold pinch her fingertips. They hadn't had their first frost yet, not even at night, but the air was heavy with that typical Danish winter damp, the kind that penetrated deep into her bones and numbed her hands and feet. The hinges creaked, and she heard the officer next to her gasp. In the open suitcase lay a body. Its skin was brownish-purple with white, mouldy stains, and it took Anette a second to even recognize the shape as human. The body had only one arm and one leg. Its head was squashed into one corner and had been sliced clean through. Instinctively, she lifted her eyes away from the body. The sky above her was grey, and the air dense with fine little beads of water. The stench was overwhelming. A guttural sound escaped the young officer. Anette quickly closed the lid before he threw up.
Earth to earth.
The pastor stuck his shovel into a pile of dirt and carefully threw it down onto the white coffin while pushing a pair of glasses farther up his nose with the index finger of his other hand.
Ashes to ashes, dust to dust.
The small group clustered around the grave stood motionless in the drizzle, following the rites. Jeppe Kørner put his arm around Esther De Laurenti and felt her skinny body shaking under the fabric of her coat. His hand on her shoulder was still sore from carrying the casket. Jeppe surveyed the other burial guests, surprised at the absence of Gregor's own relatives. Other than Esther and himself, only a few former colleagues and elderly acquaintances had shown up. The three adult children, and who knows how many grandchildren and great-grandchildren, hadn't come, pushed away in an ugly divorce many years ago and never reconciled, not even for the final farewell. Gregor's had not left behind much of a mark on the world. The pastor said the Lord's Prayer and gave the benediction, and Jeppe felt a little choked up. His sadness was for both Gregor's insignificance and his own, the fleeting presence of all beings here on this earth. The doctors had discovered the lung cancer in the spring and given up treatment at the peak of summer. Now they stood on the threshold of winter, burying Gregor's Hermansen, retired typographer, Esther's roommate, and father of three children he no longer knew. Esther had tended him until the end and managed to keep him at home so he didn't have to go into hospice. Jeppe lacked the imagination to conceive of how hard that must have been, but he sensed that her previously slender figure had shrunk even more and saw more grey in her henna-dyed hair.
Fearless when our path below pleases God our Father.
The group's voices sounded fragile among the headstones. Jeppe's toes were numb inside his dress shoes as he shook hands and parted ways with the other mourners. Esther only made it a few yards before she turned to him. He folded his arms around her and let her cry against his chest until she was calm. They continued together to the nearest cemetery exit, side by side on the paved paths along cypresses and stone angels. "No wake?" She shook her head and said, "I called Jakob, his eldest son, but the family doesn't wish to participate, and I don't know any of Gregor's former colleagues, so I didn't have anyone to arrange it for. Isn't there a cafe right out here on Tagensvei? Could I buy you lunch?" He smiled at her. She addressed colourfully, as she usually did, in a blue wool coat and orange silk blouse, but her face was set to black. "Or we could just have coffee, whatever we'd like. What I'd like is a glass of wine, even if it's early. Then that's what we'll do." The cafe was high-ceilinged and bright, with big windows facing the street and bentwood chairs around crowded marble tables. Apart from a sleepy wait person, the place was empty. They sat down by the window. The server stretched and started rooting around for menus. "I haven't been out since Gregor's got sick, you know? And now..." Jeppe was about to say something about how life goes on, but stopped himself. The last thing a grieving person needs is to be reminded that the world keeps going, unaffected, indifferent to their misfortune. The server placed menus on their table and began describing the day's specials. Jeppe interrupted him. "We're going to start with a bottle of the house red and some water, thanks. Then maybe we'll take a look at lunch afterward." Jeppe let the server disappear behind the bar before he took Esther's hand. "It must have been hard on you, taking care of him all on your own." "A home health aide came every day," she said with a smile, "so I had breaks. It was much harder for Gregor's than it was for me, having to depend on someone else for help. But still, do you know..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.